We want to welcome you here this morning to our service. I want to say the presence of the Lord is not limited to walls. It's not limited to brick and mortar, but it is wherever you are here this morning. We ask you that you would worship with us. Amen. And worship Him because He is worthy of praise. He is an awesome God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Lord, you are awesome. Lord, you are awesome. Lord, you are awesome. Lord, you are awesome. If it wasn't for your love, if it wasn't for your grace, I don't know where I'd your grace. I don't know where I'd be without you. Lord, you are awesome.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you are awesome. Lord, you are
to lift your hands to Him. He is an awesome God. Lord, we love you this morning. God, we're so thankful for what you are. We're so thankful, Lord, that we can feel your presence this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hear our cry, be lifted high in this place. Lord, we want you, no one.
right where you are. Could you just lift your hands to him? Hallelujah. Wherever you are this morning, whatever it is that you're doing, I'm here to tell you that miracles can happen. He's still on the throne. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, we love you.
Heaven is trembling in all of the wonders.
Hallelujah, Jesus. We're so thankful for your presence, God. Lord, we need your presence more today than we need anything. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. God bless you. Amen. As Pastor comes. Amen. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Why don't you just right now, wherever you're at, why don't you just lift your hands and your voices? Let's just call out to him, Lord, I love you. God, I thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your matchless, wonderful love. Thank you, Jesus, that when I get into the presence, come into your presence, God, that I can find fullness of joy, hope. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, there is nothing that can compare the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, I know that somebody is feeling what we're feeling in this house right now. Let's just be sensitive to the Holy Ghost. Oh, hallelujah. There is no riches that can compare to you. There is no righteousness that is your equal. God, there is nothing that can compare to your wonderful presence. Oh, hallelujah. Your Bibles, and I trust you have your Bibles, because if your phone was at one point your Bible, now that's become your connection. So I invite you to turn with me in the Word of God that you're holding in your hands to 2 Timothy chapter number 2. While you're turning, let me say thank you for all of your prayers, all of the kind words, the text messages, and the messages. Thank you so much. And I can testify today that though this may be an unconventional avenue of communication, that yet when we come in here, the praise teams that have been a part of bringing services to you and making your home a Bethel, that when we come in here, you can feel the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost. It's a wonderful feeling to know that power in the presence of God is not predicated on the populace of the pew. But I'm thankful for your prayers. It is wonderful to feel the presence and the power of God, and to know that I'm connected to a body of believers that is praying, and that they are searching and seeking the will of God for revival. I love you, every one of you, the church that I'm so privileged to pastor. And if I carry in this vein, I will just communicating and talking. 2 Timothy chapter number 2, when I feel the Holy Ghost is laid on my heart to encourage somebody. We'll start reading at verse number 8, and then we'll stop at verse number 9. It says, "Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer even unto bonds. But the word of God is not bound." I'll confess to those that are listening to me today, and the few that are present here, allowing this service to go forth and making it possible, I have preached from this numerous occasions. I have found numerous ways to thread it into my message and thread it into my preaching. But until the last few days, it has never meant more to me than it has right now. It says, when I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. I want to preach with the help of the Holy Ghost to you on this Sunday morning on just this simple thought, a prisoner's perspective. A prisoner's perspective. I want to preach about the viewpoint of the man who writes these words. And perhaps when it's all said and done, you will be as encouraged as I was when I began to examine the life and the voice and the hand that penned these words. Once again, a prisoner's perspective. Why don't you put your Bibles down? Let's lift our voices and our hands unto the Lord right now. God, I thank you for your presence. God, I thank you for your power. God, I feel an angelic visitation in this house right now. God, I pray that the anointing and the moving of the Holy Ghost, it would go forth into every home, into every life. And God, that you would touch our minds and our hearts and our spirits. Though, God, we may be separated by distance, and we may be separated, Jesus, by the issues of the day, that, God, let us be in one mind and in one accord for the next few moments. Jesus, as a people of God coming together, to feel your presence and to feel your power. Help me, God, to respond in my spirit, respond in my life to the preached word of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Keep your Bibles handy. Once again, a prisoner's perspective. It was the Apostle Paul sensing perhaps that his life was drawing to a final conclusion. Perhaps he had overheard the conversations of the magistrates of the prison, hearing what was to be the final plans for his imprisonment and the Roman government's intentions for his life. It can be very well read and rendered that in these moments when one's life is drawing to an expected end, that men and women, they often find themselves in moments of reflection, retracing the steps, the memories, and the moments that brought them to this conclusion of their life. I believe that it was a combination of conversation and prayer that brought Paul to this place in his life. I am confident that he took inventory as he looked around him of the dark, dank dungeon in which he was held, and the power of God which was still within him, never leaving and never being subject to the restraints of mortal man. Though his body is undoubtedly tired, and it's perhaps even failing him as he pens these words, perhaps by the fading light that was entering his cell, yet he gives us this hope and this understanding that God's word, it is ever faithful. I do not believe that Paul sat with folded hands, taking a visual inventory of everything that was around him, of his current accommodations, as some would do at that point. Certainly all could have made the argument none better, though, than Jesus Christ, that what he would have endured and accomplished for the ministry would have gave him reason for a moment of personal reflection. Perhaps even the leading many to ask this of God, what have I done to deserve this fleecing finality in these few moments of my life? I've served faithfully. I have given diligently to the house of God. And it would probably cause some of us to survey the surrounding situations and circumstances of our life. And we would look to God, and we would ask him, why has the course of my life been charted this way? I could look around the house of God here today, and my voice as it echoes throughout the halls of this hallowed place. Yet I find it fascinating and perhaps greater what is not said than what Paul
pens these words. Paul does not write of his current conditions of the prison. We find those out through biblical history, that if you were to visit the very place in Rome where he was held in the final moments of his life, it was a place no bigger than probably 6 feet by 6 feet, and it wasn't big enough for him to actually even stand up in. And the sewers of Rome, they ran through that place, and the mice and the rats and the vermin and the filth, they accompanied him every day of his life. But Paul, he does not focus upon any of that. So I find it fascinating. It's not what he said that really encourages me, that what he said, Paul writes of the current conditions. And Paul could have justifiably put away his pen and folded his hands and waited for the final moments of his life to unfold. He could have reasoned within himself, I've done enough in my ministry. I've fulfilled the purpose and the calling of God to an extent that he couldn't justify the final moments of his life having sitting on his hands and awaiting the executioner's act. Yes, the Apostle Paul at certain times in his life, he does speak of the chains, and yet he does reference them not as an obstacle to overcome. Rather, he views and writes of them as an opportunity to bring him closer to an understanding and to witness the wonder and the working and the power of God. Yes, the Apostle Paul, he is in prison, but he could not be silenced. We read of his epistles because he refuses to put away his pen, and even the most rank of conditions in which he was living was not enough for him to cause to deviate from the purpose and the calling of his life. Even while he is in prison, he still teaches and he still seeks to convert everyone that is around him. And with this pen, he writes to those that were endeavoring to propagate the gospel. Paul, he turns his focus and his attention not only to those that he can reach in the prison, but beyond the walls as well, making everyone, not just those that were in his immediate vicinity, but making generation after generation after generation his captive audience, until this very day and this very moment that I lift my text and my inspiration from the words of Paul. It was the perspective of a prisoner that was buried in the very sewer of Rome that he pins these words, that the word of God, it cannot be bound. I'm telling somebody in this house today that no matter what you're dealing with, no matter what you're going through, no matter how great the trial may be in your life, look at the perspective of a prisoner and take hope that the word of God cannot be bound in this place. So, hallelujah. Even while in prison, he still teaches. Even while in prison, he still preaches. If not for his imprisonment, he would have never reached the Roman soldiers that were chained to him every day of his receding life. The wardens of the prison, the servants of Caesar's own household, and even the officers that were presiding over his imperial tribunal. Paul taking inventory of the miracles that he had witnessed, and the revival that was spreading like wildfire throughout Rome, and what the power of God was being accomplished even while under arrest and in constant chains. So today I celebrate the perspective of a prisoner when Paul looked at what all of God was doing, what he had wrought in Rome, what God had done with his life while under house arrest and in a prison, and he looks at the conditions in which he was living, and he reviewed the manner in which it was made manifest, and he draws this conclusion that there is nothing that can bind the word of God. There is no trial, there is no tribulation, and there is nothing in this life that could bind the power of the word of God. Oh, hallelujah. It brings greater power and joy to this verse of scripture. that Paul just did not pen this verse out of simple devotion, yet out of power. In rejoicing, he declares, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even under bonds, but the word of God is not bound. Every saint of God and every individual who is still hanging their heads in doubt and wringing their hands in disbelief at the current conditions, they need to understand that no matter the circumstances, God's truth cannot be bound and it cannot be contained. My words will fail and falter, yet God's word lives. And it resides in this house today. I can feel it in this house. I can feel it moving and working among us. I know this today, that my words may fail and they may falter. So pardon me while I plagiarize from the word of God. Ephesians 3:20 says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think according the power that worketh in us. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Matthew 19:26, but Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Matthew 11:28-29, come unto me all ye that labor and are heavy burden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls. Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the thoughts that you think towards me, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Isaiah 40:29-31, he giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. That's the word of God. It's written and contained within the margins of your Bible, and it cannot be bound. I don't care the circumstances. I don't care the voices. I don't care the devices. Nothing can conspire to stop the power of the word of God. Oh, hallelujah. Philippians 4:19 says, but my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Romans 8:37-39 says, nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Don't take my word for it. Take the word of God. Don't just listen to me. Find yourself in the word of God. You'll find joy. You'll find triumph. You'll find the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I cannot be bound because the word of God cannot be bound in this day. However, if you are fearful as the current conditions of the world, and you're wondering what is going to take place, let me tell you, I've got complete peace because I have this promise. John 16:33, Jesus declares, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Looking at Paul's life was a representation of this promise. In the world, he suffered as an evildoer, being subject to trials and tribulations. Yet it not from the trouble and the chains that Paul writes. It is from the peace that can only be found in Christ Jesus and his wonderful word. There is a peace that can be found in salvation that this world it cannot offer. There's a peace that can be found in the repentance of your sins. There's a joy that can be found in the baptism in Jesus' name for the remission of your sins. And there is a hope that can be found in joy unspeakable when you lift your hands and you're filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost, evidenced by speaking in other tongues. Stop looking to the world for solutions, promises, and hope. Make your way to the one, the only one, the God of all heaven, who at Calvary overcame not only the world, but death, hell, and the grave. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. I can walk today in perfect peace because my hope is not found in this world. My hope and faith are in the one who already overcame the world. John 1 and 11 declares, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Jesus Christ was the living embodiment of the Old Testament Word, robed in flesh and came and dwelt among us and crucified at Calvary. That is why Paul could declare that the Word of God, it could not be bound. God has been with us from the beginning, for it is Word that framed the universe and the firmament of our feet. He created the world in which we are at. Death and hell could not defeat Him. The grave could not hold Him. And Satan could not triumph because Christ, he descended to the bowels of hell and he took the very keys to Satan's kingdom. This is why Paul could write God's word. It cannot be bound. I'm telling somebody today, there's a promise that can unlock your future. There's a hope in the word of God that can bring peace and calm to your life. The answer for what you need is not found on the evening news. Is found in the Word of God. The answer for your family is not found in philosophy. It's found in the Word of God. It's here. It's powerful. And it cannot be bound. Oh, hallelujah. That's why Paul could pen these words. It was the perspective of a prisoner who witnessed the limitations of his own life and the frailty of his own flesh. Yet everywhere around him, he seen the abounding power and purpose of the Word of God. He seen what it was doing in Caesar's household. He seen the Roman centurions chained to his body as they were converted. He seen prisoners, the rank of society, as they confessed and professed and were filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. Don't tell me the Word of God cannot help you. Don't tell me the Word of God cannot make amends in your life. There's no sin. There's no circumstance. There's no trial that is too great for the power and the Word of God. For God's Word, it cannot be bound. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. If you're living bound and being held captive by current events, fear, frustration are there when you close your eyes at night. And they're the first to greet you when you wake up in the morning. Then rejoice over the words of Paul that nothing can bind the Word of God. God's Word is not bound or would make the calling of my life a lie. And every message that has preceded me from this pulpit would have been shackled to the limitations deemed by this world. The only thing that can bind the Word of God is unbelief. Matthew 13 and 58 says, "And he did not mighty many works because there was unbelief. For if God's Word was bound, It would force the people of God to forfeit their hopes. If God's word was bound, it would cause people to lose out their promises, to abandon their prayer lives. But God's word is not bound. God's word is not bound. Paul could preach, and we have evidence that he did. And it was with his constraint to his shackles, nor was it with faith faltering to match his living conditions. He did not descend the word of God into the very depths and the depravity of which he had found himself. Paul refused to let his faith sink to the living conditions of this present world. Paul refused to allow the final moments of his life to be conquered by the dungeon in which he was living. He refused to allow the circumstances of his life at the very waning days to snatch from him the purpose and the passion for which he had propagated, reached, and been a missionary all of those years. Justifiably, yes. Woe is me. Probably the majority of us would say that. But not Paul. There was something that welled up on the inside of the Apostle Paul. There was something about his ministry and his walk with God. There was something about it that when he witnessed the conditions of the dungeon in which he was living, I believe that he looked at the filth and was reminded, there's going to be streets of gold one day. I believe that he looked at the cold, dark stone walls that surrounded him, and I believe that he rejoiced because he knew of the promise. Gates of pearl, walls of jasper. I believe that when we looked at all the conditions, the dank, dark depravity in which he finally found just a little bit of light of day to pen his epistles, yet he remembered there's going to be a day where the lion is going to sit next to the lamb, and the light of God is never going to be extinguished. And I think it was from the perspective of a prisoner that something welled up on the inside of the Apostle Paul, and he pens for us the testimony of his life. I know I suffer as an evildoer, but know this, Timothy, the word of God, it cannot be bound. You cannot judge the word of God and his promises by the conditions of this world. My God is greater than this world. He has already overcome the world, and he's got the keys to death, hell, and the grave to prove it. Paul could preach, and we have the evidence that he did, but it was without restraint to match his shackles. And his faith, it did not falter. History tells us that every centurion that was chained to him, they were converted, that they had to change the prison guards every so often because they were infected by the power and the presence of God. It got so great that even Caesar's household, in Paul's epistle, said that we greet the church. What a great revival from a dungeon. You know why? Because the word of God cannot be bound. I know today that we may seem like we're living in a dungeon, but the perspective of a prisoner is this. Revival is going to take place. Healing can abound. The anointing of the Holy Ghost can touch your family because the word of God cannot be bound. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. He preached and shared the word of God with enough passion and purpose that it found its way and took root in the very center of the Roman Empire, in Caesar's household. I don't know if that pagan dictator realized it, but he was being served by the hands of a child of God. I know some of you right now don't even realize it, and you don't know it, but you are being served by the hands of God and the Word of God. Why? Because His Word, it cannot be bound. I know that if the Word of God can find its way from the prison to the household of Caesar, what is flowing in this house, what we film on this platform, what this church represents, it can find its way into your life, into your family, into your home at this very moment. Oh, hallelujah. What you're feeling right now, that's the Holy Ghost. You've probably never felt it before in your life. It's the Word of God that cannot be bound. I've got faith right now. If you would lift your hands and your voice, that God would fill you with a gift of the Holy Ghost. And you would not be bound by something that does not feel right, but you would yield to the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost in your living room, in your home, driving down the road. You can be filled with a gift of the Holy Ghost, because God's Word, it does not respect the barriers of this world. I'm going 20 centuries after the execution of Paul, we still got Bibles and the abounding power of the Word of God. 20 centuries removed from Paul going to the chopping block. I stand here today, seemingly a prisoner of my circumstances, but my faith abounding, because I know what Paul witnessed, what Paul wrote, and what Paul preached is still in relation today. His Word, it cannot be bound. Paul witnessed the promises of God even in the middle of persecution. The very Philippian jailer that beat him to within an inch of his life, chained him to the prison wall. He and his family are converted at the miraculous visitation of the Holy Ghost, baptized in Jesus' name, and filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. I find the irony in the method of God's Word. A jailer, a man who made it his life's mission to keep people bound, was now promoting a promise that could not be bound. Oh, hallelujah. We've seen throughout the course of history, ministers have preached from prison to witness revival because the Word cannot be bound. Some may burn Bibles, yet its truth abides. Even the doctrines at times may seem extinct, but it was revived because God's Word cannot be bound. If they get ready behind me to sing, I wonder if everybody under the sound of my voice that is not only in this house, but in your homes, in your vehicles, in your jobs, that you would just stop what you're doing right now and just lift your hands and your voices and begin to seek after the presence and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I'm telling somebody today, even though his flesh was buried for 3 days, it was not bound because Christ, he was busy himself binding the sin, the circumstances, and what you're facing today. I'm telling you, God has already took dominion over your sin, your circumstance. You've just got to welcome the power and the presence of God into your life. Even from a prison, Paul seen the wonderful working of the power of God. You can see it in your homes. You can see it in your children. You can see it in your personal life. Only you can stop the moving and the working of the Holy Ghost. Because even when I cannot see it, even when I cannot feel it, there's a promise that is abounding in somebody's life. That's what Paul was preaching. Even though I cannot see it, I know the Word of God will accomplish its intended and an expected end. That is the gospel and the good news of the saints as they lead us in worship. Will you lift your hands and your voice unto the Lord right now and just begin to entertain that presence and power of the Holy Ghost that we feel in this place?
You are here. working in this place. I worship you.
Hallelujah.
I worship you. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. I worship you.
I wonder wherever you are, could you just lift your hands to him? Could you just lift your hands to him and say, God, I know you're here. I know you're with me. I know you're an ever-present help. God, I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. Oh, come on. He is a way maker.
Way maker. Miracle worker. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Even when I don't see it, your word.
Hallelujah. Can I just, wherever you are this morning, whatever situation you're in, I wonder before we leave if you could just raise your hands to him. Say, God, I put my trust in you. I put my trust in the Word of God. Hallelujah. I know, Lord, that you're with me. Hallelujah. Oh, can we just worship him 1 minute before we leave? God, I love you. God, I worship you. God, I give you all the praise. Because of who you are, God, I know, Lord, that you are the way maker. God, I know that you are the miracle worker. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We want to say we miss every one of you. We love you. We miss you, and we're looking forward to the day when we get to see you again. But as we dismiss this morning, can we just raise our hand one more time and give him the praise that he is worthy of right where you are, sitting in your living room, wherever you are. I want you to just to put everything down, take a moment and raise your hands and say, God, I love you. The presence of the Lord be with you. Let it feel it right where you are this morning. May God bless you this morning. May God, may you feel his presence. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.